48 years of age. And the clerk said, well, he's a senior citizen. And she said, well, what makes you think he's a senior citizen? And he said, well, he looks like a senior citizen. So we all laughed about that, and the manager let the senior discount stand, and I always got a senior discount there from that day on. Now, I don't know about here at Richmond Hill, but at Marion, we list the birthdays, the upcoming birthdays, in the bulletin. And so that same year, it was year that I was 48, it came time that my July 7 birthday was being announced in the bulletin. And we had some visitors at services this particular day. And one of our older ladies, who she and I had a lot of fun poking back at each other from time to time, but we were all welcoming these particular visitors, and Sister Cooper was showing them in the bulletin that I was having a birthday. And she said, doesn't he look good for 60 years of age? So I just assumed everybody understood that to be a joke. Well, in a few days, I got a card in the mail from those visitors wishing me a happy 60th birthday. But I like the fact that most people do have some respect for the age. I was concerned a few years ago when then Colorado Governor Richard Lamb, in a discussion about health care costs, said that terminally ill people have a duty to die and get out of the way. Most people would be more polite than that, but I think actually some people think that way, and that's a terrible kind of thought. But what should we be doing, and how should we prepare for our old age, and what should we do in that old age? I want us to look at one of the Psalms, Psalm 71. And though it's 24 verses, I'm going to take time to read that psalm, and then we're going to study it some. Psalm 71, verse 1. In thee, O Lord, do I put my trust. Never let me be put to confusion. Deliver me in thy righteousness, and cause me to escape. Incline thine ear unto me, and save me. Be thou my strong habitation, whereunto I may continually resort. Thou hast given commandment to save me, for thou art my rock and my fortress. Deliver me, O my God, out of the hand of the wicked, out of the hand of the unrighteous and cruel man. For thou art my hope, O Lord God. Thou art my trust from my youth. By thee have I been holding up from the womb. Thou art he that took me out of my mother's bounds. My praise shall be continually of thee. I am as a wonder unto many, but thou art my strong refuge. Let my mouth be filled with thy praise and with thy honor all the day. Cast me not off in the time of old age. Forsake me not when my strength faileth. For mine enemies speak against me, and they that lay wait for my soul take counsel together, saying, God hath forsaken him. Persecute and take him, for there is none to deliver him. O God, be not far from me. O my God, make haste for my help. Let them be confounded and consumed that are adversaries to my soul. Let them be covered with reproach and dishonor that seek my hurt. But I will hope continually and will yet praise thee more and more. My mouth shall show forth thy righteousness and thy salvation all the day, for I know not the numbers thereof. I will go in the strength of the Lord God. I will make mention of thy righteousness, even of thine only. O God, thou hast taught me from my youth, and hitherto have I declared thy wondrous works. Now also, when I am old and gray-headed, O God, forsake me not, until I have showed thy strength unto this generation, and thy power to every one that is to come. Thy righteousness also, O God, is very high, who hast done great things, O God, who is like unto thee. Thou, which hast showed me great and sore troubles, shall quicken me again, and shall bring me up again from the depths of the earth. Thou shalt increase my greatness, and comfort me on every side. I will also praise thee with the psaltery, even the truth, O my God. Unto thee will I sing with the harp, O thou Holy One of Israel. My lips shall greatly rejoice when I sing unto thee, and my soul which thou hast redeemed. My tongue also shall talk of thy righteousness all the day long, for they are confounded, for they are brought unto shame that seek my hurt. This is the song of an old man. He is an old man with many trials and problems, but he is obviously a joyful man who is able to put his focus on the Lord in the midst of all these trials. And the psalm shows us, to put it simply, that God's way to grow old is to walk with him. The reason that the psalmist could handle his problems so well as an old man was that through the years, from his youth, even making mention from his mother's womb, he had developed a walk with God through the years leading up to this time. And he had a proven resource in the Lord, which enabled him to be strong inside, even though his body was growing weaker and his enemies were powerful. Now, in my Bible, this psalm is not one that lists an author. And various authors have been suggested for this psalm, but I am inclined to attribute it to David, the sweet singer of Israel. There are various elements in the psalm that seem to tie in with other of David's known psalms. Reference to the psaltery and the harp certainly seems to be David. Seems to have been written during the time of his son's rebellion against him, Absalom. And so it's a hard time for David. But he's able to bear and to continue, even though he is oppressed, even though enemies are speaking evil against him and seek to kill him, even though he has suffered so many of life's troubles, because he has trusted in God, and trusted in God from his youth. He is now old and gray. If this is a Psalm of David, he is undoubtedly in his 60s at this time, nearby his death at age 70. One of the things that I take note of in this psalm is that he has been faithful to God from his youth. And we know the history of David as a young man, how that he had faith in God and went up against the giant Goliath. I made mention earlier that I obeyed the gospel in 1972. I was 20 years of age at the time. The only thing that I could have wished for better than that was that if I had been raised in the church and had opportunity to obey the gospel even before that. Because I can think of some of my friends in high school and all that I might would have been able to have encouraged with the gospel had I been exposed to it sooner. But I'm glad that at least by age 20, I had learned the truth of God's word and had been obedient to the gospel plan of salvation. This psalmist tells us and shows us that we need to develop a very deep knowledge of the Lord. This psalm is permeated with a deep personal understanding and practical knowledge of the Lord God. We've made mention that he'd been taught of God even from his youth. The man knew God not only as his refuge, but verse 7, as his strong refuge, his righteous Savior. He calls God his rock of habitation, his rock and his fortress, his hope and his confidence. He talks of God's mighty deeds. Look at verse 19, thy righteousness also, O God, is very high, who has done great things, O God, who is like unto thee. He realized it was God who brought him into trouble and God who delivered him. Verse 20, he says, thou hast showed me great and sore troubles. But yet he understands that God will quicken him again and bring him up again from the depths of the earth. We live long enough, we'll face a lot of struggles in life. And as God has continued to see us through all things, we can be continually assured that he will see us through yet again. He realized that God was his source and comfort in all these trials. In verse 23, that God had redeemed his soul. My lips shall greatly rejoice when I sing unto thee, and my soul, which thou hast redeemed. We sing songs about redemption all the time, don't we? Redeemed how I love to proclaim it. Redeemed by the blood of the Lamb. And we rejoice in knowing that we have been redeemed by God. And so, again, he said, O God, who is like unto thee? Well, of course, nobody. And so his deep knowledge and practical knowledge and understanding of God enabled his mouth to be filled with God's praise or God's glory and God's righteousness all the day long, he says. We must study and learn and practice the scriptures. I don't want to embarrass anybody, but how many in this room have read every word of the Bible? Okay. Those that haven't, I would challenge you to have it as a spiritual goal before your death. To read every word that God, through his Holy Spirit, has preserved for us. So that we can have this deep, tremendous personal understanding and practical knowledge of the Lord. And that includes the Old Testament. Because Paul said in Romans 15 and verse 4 that whatsoever things were written before time were written for our learning, that we through patience and comfort of the scriptures might have hope. And so as we read all of these stories, even from the Old Testament, it gives us great hope in God. This man, David, I believe, knew God. And it is obvious that he had known God for years, and that God's faithfulness had been proved to him in a number of previous difficult situations. And so now he's in a difficult situation. But he doesn't approach it like the weak in faith do. You know, sometimes when illness strikes, particularly if it's one of our children, when some kind of financial crisis comes or whatever, the weak in faith might pray, God, if you're real, this and that. God, whoever you are, this or that. God, if you're really out there, I need your help. We, the older people in the church, need to be the great encouragement to the younger people of the church to never have such a detachment from God. But we must help them be convinced that God is our refuge, that God is our protection, that there is none like unto God, and that God will see us through the trials and tribulations of life. I've relied upon the faith of older people many times. And I've said before on a number of occasions that I think surely one of the most challenging things to a person's faithful well-being might well be the loss of a child. And I've known Christians who have lost children. I came home from India in 2008. About 3 days after being back, I got a call. My younger daughter, Patsy, 15 years of age at the time, had stayed overnight with a friend of hers for a birthday party that they had, and so the mother had taken some of the girls shopping the next day. And a large SUV was being driven by a man who blacked out at the wheel, and he crashed into the store and drove over my daughter. And she was at the brink of death. And I can tell you that it was the strength of older Christians that I relied on a lot during that time, who I knew who had been through so much themselves before, and they were able to get through it. I preached a sermon from Joshua chapter 3, where Joshua and the elders were preparing to take God's people across the Jordan River into the promised land. And they told the people to stand back 2,000 cubits from the Ark of the Covenant so that everybody could see the Ark of the Covenant. And they said, wherever the Ark of the Covenant goes, you follow that, because that's God's path for you, and this is the way that you have not traveled before. And I told the congregation through tears, I said, my family has not traveled this way before. I said, but all we can do is stand back and look at the Ark of the Covenant, and wherever God takes this, we will follow. But we trust that somehow it will be for the furtherance of the gospel. And so many of the older people in the congregation were able to say, Michael and Carolyn, we have been there. God will get you through this. Now, when I'm faced with somebody who faces that kind of tragedy, I can put my arm around them and say, I have been there. God is our strong refuge. God will take us through this and lead us in His way. It's time for a break. Does anybody have anything you wish to say? We can certainly be interactive in our program.